the antenna range.
Yeah.
I haven't forgotten it.
No, it's all right.
But I've got a list, Mike.
Yeah, sure.
Right.
Yeah.
It is an excellent opportunity.
I thought so.
All right. Interesting though. Guys, big thing is, Hans and I are talking to the work group, IRU work group, and long and the short is, and I'm getting more and more convinced of the following fact, is that why they've asked us to prepare a paper, Hans is looking after it, and why they kind of, Hans, they're on their own mission as far as I'm concerned. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
But at the end of the day, they come back and they ask us, why? Because we have a hands-on approach. Pity that we are a few today. But I'm sure there's some underlying reason for it. Nevertheless, I said to them last year in September, I said, guys, forget about the statistical models. Forget about the calibrated antennas. Forget about the, they've got a yay long list of very valid issues that you need to look at. But the long and the short is these things need to get off the ground, like in yesterday, because we do not have information. We don't have that statistics. I forwarded to Hans an article yesterday in the Popular Mechanics, South African edition, about electric vehicles. I haven't read the full thing as yet, Hans, but I highlighted that one portion, okay? First of all, what counts in our favor is, first, the batteries, to charge these batteries, a huge amount of current is required. The cost factor is completely, what's the word, out of range of the ordinary guy in this league at this point in time. So we still have a little bit of time on our side. But these manufacturers are pushing second to none. I was at the BMW factory. I was nearly run over by one of these vehicles. Because you don't hear, I mean, we got off the bus and started walking across diagonally, and this vehicle came from the back. They, at the time, in our world, we talk about a cable plugging it into the vehicle. No, it's not so true, guys. We're talking about a pad. Vince, they want these, like you charge your cell phones, right? That's it. Now imagine a townhouse complex. Everybody pulls in between 5 and 6 in the evenings. What happens? You pull in and that thing starts charging. There's an RF component in the communications between the vehicle and this pad. And that's that in itself is killing 40, 80, 160, it's gone. Simple as that. Alright? Back at the working group. Yes, I agree with him. You know, we've got to standardize things. And that's why Vince is here today, giving us some info, and we'll discuss the antenna portion of our little setups. But I believe very strongly that the sooner we start feeding data onto the server, the better. No two ways about it. We are setting an example, and I think we need to up our game at this point in time, Hans. We really need to get guys going and spread these stations. And the subtle excuses, I call it subtle excuses, is that, yeah, but I cannot operate HF while my receiver is running, collecting data. Come on, switch over the damn thing. Work HF, switch it on again. It's as simple as that. This is the subtle piece that we need to just move aside and get the guys proactive and involved so that we can set the example in South Africa, because we're going to need that information rather sooner than later. All right. See, the latest legislation is this. What they're talking about is the solar panels. You got to register solar.
Have you ever heard more bullshit in your life?
Can you believe it? My little generator. I've got now registers. Oh, come on, where's these guys going? So if they can become so ridiculous, we can become also ridiculous from the other side with the necessary statistics. and start the morning as well. How about that? All right, guys. Thanks for joining us. Vince, thank you for taking the time. We're looking forward to your presentation. Anton, weer eens groot dankie van jou kant af. Anton said to me the workshop in Durban was a huge success, and possibly some follow-up later in the year. I'm sure there's, because if the guys are very enthusiastic, there's no two ways about it. The word spreads, and we will keep going. All right, there you are.
Thanks very much. I just like to give you an update on some of the things. You know, we talk about interference on HF, and we actually pay very little attention to the fact about interference that may affect satellites and on the VHF and UHF frequencies. There's an interesting case that came to light on Thursday when CENTEC had a big shindy here and they reviewed some of their trials they did on DRM, DRM 30, and on DAB Plus. Now these are two digital audio platforms that will be ultimately replacing FM. When one day they get television DTT sorted out, maybe they will go ahead and start doing that. There was just a very big discussion about that, and one of the points is their license to pilot or to trial DAB2 runs out on the 10th of May. So the discussion and the hints to the councillor from ICASA that was also at the meeting yesterday, Thursday, was that they should extend and give them a further trial license. Why? Because what they found is that in Pretoria, they operated the trial on 5 kilowatt and 10 kilowatt. Also 1 kilowatt, but 1 kilowatt was not really an option. In Pretoria, on the 5 kilowatt, it worked extremely well in most instances, even under bridges, inside buildings. 10 kilowatt, of course, really took it to all the thick walls of buildings. And it the coverage area is good. Now, the reason they want to do the trial, continue with it, because in Joburg, they couldn't operate the 10 kilowatt transmitter. For the simple reason that there was too much other noise that they caused such interference in other systems. So that means is that the electromagnetic compatibility of other systems in the Joburg area was so bad that it actually, this transmitter swamped it. But on the other hand, when you look at the results of the 5 kilowatt transmission and you compare that with the Pretoria 5 kilowatt transmission, then you'll see that Joburg had a problem because the noise level is so much higher. And what they're using a frequency that's quite high up in the 600-700 megahertz or something in that region. So the whole point now is, and I'm actually busy investigating it, and I want to write an article about the kind of issues they found, and they've made all the information available to me. But the whole point is that on VHF and UHF, and with weak signal operation that you find on the satellite, for argument's sake, you're also going to find this problem. So therefore, the MSET people start thinking they can have to join this kind of like initiative, but look at some of the satellite frequencies. There was an interesting email on the MSET, what do they call it? It's like a forum, it's a bit different to our forum that we have here. And there was an email in the last few days where they also actually started talking about the problems they had with receiving telemetry of some of the newer CubeSats because of the noise level in their environment. So therefore this whole thing that because you're digital, because you're on high frequencies, that noise level doesn't matter, it's not true. So that's another area that we've got to look at, but you know, we're concentrating on HF here. And let's leave it like it, and let's find some other people that want to go and look at the other frequencies. But it's an area of concern. But it was just to me significant that CENTEC actually has to get another license to be able to do this, continue the trial before they can really come to a decent conclusion. How they're going to solve the problem with the extended trial on 10 kilowatt maybe they have to recite the transmitter somewhere else. But it was actually interfering in some of their own systems. So they're now waking up and saying, well, some of their systems maybe aren't up to scratch. There was a meeting yesterday of a group called TC74, which is a telecommunication regulatory group at SABS. And there was a discussion about what they're saying, sort of new problems they got to look at. And guess what appeared on there? Guess.
Noise.
No. Okay. Yeah, either way, but not.
Electric vehicles.
No. What appeared on there was broadband power line. Somebody said, wow, well, why do we want to discuss that? It's died. It's not. There's a reinsurgence of VPL in this country now.
Run by who?
I don't know. That's one of the things we need to look at.
Okay.
But I mean, if they're going ahead with that, there's a problem because we don't have any interference regulations. Because ICASA, when they started that project 10 years ago, and I chaired that subcommittee at the time, we came to sort of like a kind of arrangement where certain areas were protected, and amateur radio had some form of protection, but not quite the same as, for instance, protection that was awarded to the sea rescue, or whatever they call it, the marine radio. They had a better protection zone. And then in the end, there could be no consensus, so the draft regulations would actually remain a draft. And if you ask ICASA now, they don't know what happened to it. They just died a death. So it shows you that these kind of, and that's the reason why we as radio amateurs need to be involved in these kind of like SABS committees, because that's where you start picking up and understanding who's doing what where. And I know it's sometimes painful, because those meetings, some of these guys, they are a professional in this little bit of the big issue. And then they can spend half an hour arguing about a point until the chairman says, well, I think we've discussed it enough, let's go on to more important subjects. And then the guy will start again. It's a nightmare, but it's saying, and we're always looking for people to support us on those meetings, because this one only happens once a year. The SRL was on the broadcast subcommittee, and I've removed us from the broadcast subcommittee and I moved us to the radio communication committee, because they are the ones that are now looking at all these other communication technologies that are being discussed, for which no regulations exist, and they are now starting to look at that. But the SABS is always a problem, because now, for instance, subcommittee SC5 is the one that's now going to deal with radio communications. They haven't got a chairman. But now what happens is, they set out a vote to say, this guy's proposed to chair that subcommittee, but now you need at least 50% of all the people that are involved in that TC74 to vote. And only 3 people voted. So now they still haven't, the subcommittee can't get moving, because, and that's a problem that we have. You know, I don't know what's wrong with people in the industry. I mean, they want to be part of that, they want to make their voices heard, but when it comes to a simple thing of going to the, it's not a simple website, it's actually a horrible website. It's produced by the Standards International Standards Organization, but you have to like be, I don't know, software engineer to actually understand how to manipulate it. But once you know, then you can do it, but you've got to vote. So that they said, now, well, to make it easy, these guys that can't do that, they can send an email, and then the secretary will actually vote on their behalf on the strength of their email. So hopefully this committee gets on the go soon, and it'll be interesting. We had a number of forums in the past talking about HF on our Skype meetings, and there is now a request that we have some more, because there's guys in Durban that want to join that discussion. And people in Cape Town, because there's not that much happening, and they feel that the only way they can do is by coming part. So we will reinstitute some of those, maybe every 6 or 8 weeks or something like that, to see who wants to be interested in that Skype discussion. Skype has settled down quite nicely these days, believe it or not, and it works a lot better than it did some time back. So that's the story, but we're going to talk about a couple of things today. First of all, we're going to start and talk about GNU Radio. Interesting when people read that on the bulletin, hey, they mentioned. I've heard many versions of that. But anyway, that's we're going to talk about. Then we're going to have Vince talking about antennas, and he's given us a lot of material that we will make available on the website soon. As soon as I get a chance over the weekend, I'll load it. And you can go to the... I'll load it on the MZSA website because I have far better access and it's easy to do, but I'll put the link on SRL so you can go there. And then we're going to talk also about how to upload to the server. And yeah, maybe Anton can tell us a bit more, but I believe we have quite some interesting people that are starting to log on to look at the stuff. So it's very important for us to start adding stuff to it, looking at it. Can't look at myself because the software doesn't support my dongle.
Not yet.
But maybe I'll have to get another dongle in the meantime.
Get yourself.
So let's talk about. Sorry.
Get yourself a Raspberry Pi.
I still need a dongle, even if I have a Raspberry Pi. No, it's not the computing power I lack. Of course, okay. Dedicated laptop I can use it. So out for what I want to do, but it's good enough for that. So let's talk about GNU Radio. Thanks, Anton. And can I wire you up because I'm going to record it properly this time.
Also, I just want to make a comment. You spoke about the noise floor. Yesterday I was demoing a guy that ordered a dongle and a receiver that Anton sent me for him. And I was just scanning through from 1.7 gigs, just every 100 kilohertz, just cycling down through the frequencies. And suddenly we noticed there was a definite step up in the noise floor. Must have been about 50 meters wide. And then it dropped off again. But you could actually see it from the display of the... I was just using GQRX just to show him, yeah, what you can actually see where you've got the dongle. And it was amazing, just this.
Yeah.
And it must have been at least about a 20 dB step. Because, I mean, immediately I caught it as you were going through it.
You talked like that. Just quickly, I had the same problem last Sunday. And I had to do something and do amateur radio today. And all of a sudden, there's this huge noise coming up. And I switched off every light in my house. I switched off everything else and I couldn't get rid of it. Then I had to go to the garage for something, and I walked in there and I heard this. It was my geezer timer.
Your what?
My geezer timer. Something's gone spurious with that, but it created a huge, right across the band. I tuned from media wave right to 28 megs, and it was there.
Yeah.
And so the search. So if I had the noise system running, I would have actually been perhaps pick up what it could have been. Or we would have seen where the actual spikes were. Yeah, guess what? The thing is now in the rubbish bin. And I've got a new one which I haven't installed yet. But they last a few years. GNU Radio.
Okay. I think we will carry on where Hans has stopped now with the HF noise stuff. I've also got a few stories around picking up noise since I've put the system in place. To go to GNU Radio as a subject. Basically, GNU Radio was an open source project which was originally developed, I think, for the Linux type environment. And it's a modular system which you can, it's basically driven by a Python as an compiler. And a lot of people has now developed plugins for it. So basically it's a modular system which has blocks. And all you do in GNU Radio is link the blocks and then configure these blocks. And in principle, if you look at 2 or 3 years back, maybe there was 2 or 3 input blocks and 2 or 3 output blocks. Now there's probably 50 input blocks and 50 output blocks. There's so many things, you don't know where to. There's demodulator blocks, there's telemetry demodulator blocks, there's modulator blocks. You name it, it's there. If you want to buy, that's out there, you can now build it. And what's the nice thing about this, you can even make your own new modulation or your own new configuration. And what's nice about it to a certain extent is if you've got generic hardware for your specific interest, then it's a matter of building your blocks, doing your thing, and you can now expose it to other hands. You can download it, load it up, and you've got the same capabilities which this other hands just developed. So you maybe spend it a week building this new radio or new decoder or whatever he's done. And everybody else can have a benefit of it. So that's a very nice feature. What it also give you to a certain extent is if you don't know how to build or buy different radios for different capabilities. So if you buy the generic hardware, which is, I would say if you look at the top end ones, you're probably going to pay 50,000 for it. But you can probably start in the entry level for 2,000 to 3,000 rand, and you can go up to 6 gigs in some of these entry levels. Okay, they're not high power, but it's very great for experimental testing. You have your own lab, you've got your own spectrum analyzer, you've got everything built into this one hardware capability. And once you've got the feeling and you've played around with that capability, then maybe you can look at the more expensive ones. I think there's ones for 10 grand or 20 grand, which is 100 watt transmitters and transceivers, proper output filters and so on and so on. So I think getting your feet wet was using the RTL dongle for reception. And now we want to take it the next step. Now we can listen, we can do all these things, we can build fantastic receivers, we can do weather satellite decoding with new radio, we can do telemetry decoding of most of these new CubeSats. Fantastic, but I would like to transmit with it as well. Maybe I want to build a linear transponder with it. And you can. Come to the UNSAT conference, and I'll show you how to do it. So that's the capabilities and features that's available now in your laptop or your Raspberry Pi or whatever you've got as a base. You can probably run this in a virtual environment in Windows if you're not familiar with Linux, but I would really recommend you to start learning Linux if you haven't done it yet. You know, spend some time. There's Learn Linux in 21 Day books you can download. There's a lot of YouTube videos, lots. You can play them, stop them, learn, and get yourself familiar with the command line capabilities of Linux. It's really going to help you if you're looking at GNU Radio as a technology. So I think what I'm going to try and do today is let's build a receiver. Some of us are still using one of the RTL dongles, and then we'll build a transmitter from a concept point of view, so we can understand how it's done and how easy it is done. And in questions, we know a lot of people today, so we can make it interactive. So if you've got any questions or things, then just shout. Any questions this far? Something specific you want us to cover, maybe? Okay, so we're going to cover storing GNU Radio. So you can create we have these bootable memory sticks. So if you don't want to convert your laptop to Linux or whatever, you can make it bootable from a memory stick, or you can do a dual boot installation. You can boot Windows or Linux. Maybe that's the way to do it. Then install GNU Radio. I'll show you how to do that. We'll build the FM receiver, building FM transmitter, and then we'll cover the HF noise stuff and then the antenna stuff afterwards. Okay, so the easiest way to do it is if you use a Raspberry Pi or Linux, like I use Ubuntu here. Only command you have to run is apt install the new radio. And it will go to the internet and install all the libraries for you. Simple as that. Then now to start the new radio, you will type the command sudo GNU radio companion. That's your GUI environment where you will actually have the capability to have these blocks that I was talking about and how you to use and configure them. And this, if you go to the GNU radio website, there's even you can create a DVD, a bootable DVD to play around. You know, if you not really want to install Linux.
Search it on.
No, let's reset that. Okay.
Right. So there's different ways of transmitters, entry-level transmitters. So the ones that I recommend is a board that I've developed. It's a little 2-meter transmitter. It only transmits 35 milliwatts. There's a concept, I've done it in the previous workshop, but basically this utility, R25TX, is a transmitting capability that manipulates a single IO pin to generate RF. I've actually spoken to the developer this week of this. He's done some new libraries that really is going to make expose a lot of modulation capabilities for this. But you can do SSB, FM, and so on. He's even got this slow scan TV capability for this. So basically what you normally do, you run this command, and it will expose this transmitter on this port. And in GNU radio, you will send your modulation to that port, and it will transmit. That's a simple transmitter, but we're actually going to build one now. So I'm just giving you some concepts. So that's if you use this little board of mine. It's a 2-meter transmitter. Then another way of doing this, you can probably buy HackRF, one of these little modules. You guys can't see it. This is how it looks like. This one has got plastic around it, but the ones that we sell has got the aluminium case. It's quite nicely done. So if I remember correctly, I can't remember the frequency exactly, but it's around, I think, 1 meg up to 3 gigs. Now, what you must remember with those things, they don't have proper output filters. So although you can use all the blocks and stuff, if you really want to use it as a transmitter, an amp transmitter, you'll have to obviously build low-pass filter or band-pass filters for it, and then amplifiers and so on. So it's more an experimental capability to start off. But again, in that case, we'll just change this little plug-in here, and we'll call it HackRF. You'll see in this thing here, this HackRF block that we'll just add. And as simple as that. So the rest of the design will stay the same. But we'll do the design, so I'll show you guys. Alright, so building an FM transmitter, that's not very clear, but I just want to give you some of the concepts around what this GUI allows you to do. So basically you've got a clean canvas normally. And it would be, if you start a new canvas, there will be 3 or 4 of these little blocks at the top. Now these blocks at the top normally have just static constants that you will use is like sampling rates and things that you would use commonly across the thing, and you can reuse that constants for your thing. In this specific example, I don't think you can probably see it, but we've got an audio input, and then we've got, but we'll do it in detail now. We've got a cosine wave generator, and we mix it with the audio, and then we've got the low pass filter, and we've got a wideband FM modulator module. And then you've got a multiplier, and the reason why I've got the multiplier is the level was too low. Multiplier, this is an FFT, this is a spectrum analyzer. I can't remember what this block is, I can't even see it. And then I send it out to the HackRF. Simple as that. There's a transmitter, so it will use the audio from the microphone and transmit it out. So I'll show you how to do this. This thing here, it's got all the modules in it. So we'll go through some of them. There's audio modules, input modules, fine tube modules, debug modules, coding, NUA, there's even your NUA weather satellite one, there's some of the CubeSat one modules, there's lots of things. So we'll go through a few of the most familiar ones. So when you want to design a radio, go on the internet, Google, search for GNU Radio, FM transmitter, and you can probably download this predefined configuration, and that's your basis, and then you can start playing, adding modulators and adding this and that. It's probably a quick way to get going. This is a receiver. So this is RTL module input, a low pass filter, a wideband FM demodulator. This is the FFT, so you can actually see the spectrum that you're looking at. Can't even remember what this is. This is a multiplier, the level was too high. Audio out, audio sync. Oh yeah, one concept we need to maybe explain to you. You've got sync and source modules. So source modules is always input modules. So a source module could be an RTL dongle, or it could be a microphone input, or an audio signal coming in. Anything that comes into this is a source. Anything going out of this is a sync. So you'll see in the modules here, the sync and source modules. So if you see a source, you know it's an input module. If it says sync, you know it's an output module. So it could be RF out, it could be audio out, it could be data out, for instance, telemetry decoding, or it could be an image out, NUA image. It's an output. There's file inputs, there's file outputs. Sometimes you have got a decoder, like RTTY, and you want to see the data, and it would be a file output. There's even a little console output, so you can display it on the screen if you want to. Okay, that's basically that concept, source and sync. Once you've done this, then normally, if there's this red little thing comes up here, that means it's unhappy with one of your configurations. Now, that will happen often. Now, what you will also see is we've got this blue and we've got yellow little blocks around our blocks. Now, when we're going to start building this, you will see that that's the type of stream we the block will output to the next block. Now, you will see you can get integer, you can, like, I think, four or five different streaming formats. Now, normally, in audio, we will use one format. In the RF type or IQ mode, we will use a different streaming type because it will give you more capabilities. That's something I could get into. I actually covered it in a while back, but I've actually forgot half of it already. I'll have to refresh myself. But when we start building this receiver transmitter, I'll actually show you the differences, and maybe I'll show you which color ones is the better ones for different applications. So that's quite important. So if you try and connect a blue to a yellow, it will say red, can't do that. Then you can double click on it, go to its properties, and then change it so they are matching. So I think another thing is, which I've covered in previous workshops, but basically there's two concepts that we need to understand. You'll see there's, I'll show you the block now. Let's say we can sample RF at a frequency of 1 MHz. So we sample at an 8-bit. So it means we can have 255 levels of the RF signal, and we're sampling at 1 MHz. We now, let's say we've got a sine wave, we'll have these little dots of the RF. So what we can do mathematically, we can start calculating the dots in between, simulating that we actually took samples in between. So what that will do is it sort of gives us more data from an accuracy point of view, which is not real data, but it's simulated data. And if we use that data to then process the information further down, we actually can do much more. So that process of calculating those dots in between, I'll show you how that's done, and vice versa. Now let's say we've got too much data in the stream, too many points, we want less, then we can also tell it, okay, take make the 1 meg sampling rate maybe to 500 kilohertz, so it will take some of the dots away. And let's say the dot we want is in between two other dots, it will calculate the dot. So that's a concept that we need to learn. Another concept that's quite important when you're designing a radio is the sampling rate. Keep the sampling rate right through the process the same, except once you've gone done the audio. If you're in the RF IQ level, keep the sampling rate the same. If you start using different sampling rates, you can get all kinds of funny results. So I'll show you some of the concepts around that. Okay. Right. Okay, so I'm going to dive in let's build this. So, oops. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to start the new radio. Let me just find it here. Basically just running, I'll kill it for you. Command sudo the new radio companion. Remember the first command we would have run was apt install new radio. To do it, sync, go to internet, install it. And then the second command we'll run is this one. And you need to enter a password. And it will start up the new radio. So normally what it will do, it will have your previous projects in there. And you can obviously load them or save them. So this is an RF receiver. So I'll show you the blocks that's available, but you'll see Osmocom source. Now Osmocom is the guys that actually written the driver for the RTL dongles, manipulating it to be used for normal radio. Now there's they just this week announced a way to transmit using a USB to VGA little module board. I'm actually busy designing a board that will plug into it with proper filters, so you'll have a transmitter be available soon. So they developed most of the drivers for all input modules and most of the output modules. So for HAC RF, it's in here. For RTL dongles, it's there. So most of the RF input and output modules, you can use this source. Now, let me show you some details. So if you go to the right hand side here and you press Ctrl F, you can search for source. So that's all. Now it's updated all the source input modules. Now if you scroll down, you should see the Osmocom. There's a FanCube one, there's an Osmocom source. You'll see there's even an RTL one source. Now, what the difference is between these two, they both will allow you to do RTL dongles, but this one has got more capability, so I would recommend use the Osmocom block. So all you do is you'll take this block and drag it there, and you've got it. Now there's two of them, it's going to complain, because I've already got one there, so I'm just going to delete this one. And now you've got this block. Now if you look at this block, try and zoom in. Can you see from the back? Can you see there? Let me see if I can zoom it in a bit. No. Okay. I'll just talk through
it. At the bottom.
Where?
That bar at the right hand bottom.
This
one, yeah.
No.
Isn't that bar on my window?
Yeah, this is not Windows, this is
Linux.
I probably can, but I think it's already reasonably large. But in any case, let's just go through it. So this is a sampling rate. Remember if you use the RTL dongle, you had you know, the little gear thingy in STR Sharp, you would be able to set the sampling rate. That's exactly the same thing here. Frequency correction, you also saw that in the STR Sharp, it was always there. DC offset, you also had that in the STR Sharp. So IQ balance modes in there, gain, RF gain, IF gain, and so on and so on. So how do I configure this? So you can now create a GUI with little draggable bars, and you can say from this point to 1 to 20 is the variance for it, and then you can link it to that value there, and I'll show you how to do it. So if you double click on this thing, you get this little configuration screen. So that's quite easy. So remember I said the color, I was talking about the blue and the yellow color, that's configured here. Oops. Okay. Looks like I can only select complex float as an output, so which is blue. Some of them will allow multiples. Another important part is sampling rate. Now you see I've got a name in here, sampling rate. I could have put in there 1.4 megahertz if I wanted to type it in there. But what I did is I actually wanted a sliding bar so I can change it. So if you close this, it's a variable sampling rate. So I can search here for a variable. And drag it up here. If I can find it. Variable. So I can drag it there. And then I can take this variable and I can give it the name, whatever I want to. And then I can give it the value. So what I've done, I'm just going to show you. Created this variable, I gave it the name sample rate, and I gave it the value of 144E6, which is 1.44 megahertz, right? 1.44 to the power of 6. You could have typed it out in hertz if you wanted to, it's just this smarter ways of entering it. If you go to the internet and you look for GNU radio, get me started or how to get started, there's a lot of YouTube videos that will explain a lot of these things. So the first time you do it, it will probably stop and start and get going. But once you've done one of them, the next one is so simple to get going. So now I've set a variable, and now that variable I wanted to link that variable to this. And all I did is I retyped that same name I put in a variable in here. So if I want to reuse that value and multiple blocks across, I just type in that variable, and if I want to change it for all the blocks, I just go and change the variable. That's why you would do it. Okay. Frequency, here I've actually entered it on the screen, but I could have done it the same concept with a variable. Or I could have gone and said I wanted I'll show you something, a W-bit slider. You see this thing? This is a little sliding bar. So how the sliding bar thingy works, I can say the default value is this. I could have made it the frequency one. And I could say the maximum value, minimum is this and the maximum. So if I slide it, it will then jump with this number of steps in between. So it will calculate. I take this RX gain, you'll see it's RX gain I've configured. So this is a little slider. So if I go back here and look for RX gain, let's be further down. It's not here, it's in my multiplier. I'll scroll a bit back here. This on the power. should be this RF gain, where is it? Sound frequency. So here I could now put that slider's name. Where is it? RX underscore gain. So I can change this now. RX underscore gain. Okay. So if it doesn't find a variable, let's make it an error like that and apply. Now it will give me an error. So if I say okay, see now the thing has gone red. It says, I don't understand that variable. I don't know where to find it. So because I created RX gain here, this one here, let me drag it a bit here so you can see clearly. I need to have the name that I put into here, this ID, to be exactly the same. So I'll just go back here, I'll go to the bottom, and I'll say RX gain, change it back, and I say okay.
I can't find the network connection.
Okay, so now I've configured this RF gain to be 15 because my default value is 15. So now I can change it from 0 to 30. Makes sense. Okay, and I can do it with all this. I can drag another WX grid slider and link it to another variable. So I can now build a GUI with multiple sliders to control it. So that's the input module. Now this is a low pass filter. And this is a FFT. For you guys, do you know what is an FFT? Fast Fourier transfer? It's a spectrum analyzer, so it will show it to you in the spectrum view. So if you go in here, again we've got the sampling rate. Remember I said use the same sampling rate across all modules. So I've linked it to that same sampling rate. The baseband I've made the same as the other one. I should have actually had a little slider with the frequency, so I can change my frequency with a little slider. Okay. So I could have done it that way. I can obviously have sliders and blocks and values configured to variables if I want to. So that's the concept around that. The cutoff frequency. So the cutoff frequency is e to the 3, so it's 100 kilohertz. So it will, any frequency above that will cut off. Transition width is 10 kilohertz. So it's usable up to 10 kilohertz bandwidth. What folder mechanism will it use? That's the options we have. You can go and read about it. Some of them are sharper on the edge, some of them are more linear at the top from a filter point of view, and so on and so on. And I think the important part here this factor here, that will tell you the edge, how sharp is the edge. So you can make, if you make that value higher, the edge will be sharper. If you make it less, the edge is sloped. So you can play around with that filtering. Alright, so now we've got a receiver, we've got a low pass filter, and now we've got a wideband FM receiver module. So this is the quadrature rate. I don't even know what all these other things is. I don't know exactly what this block is doing. But there's a narrow bandwidth one and there's a wide bandwidth one. If you look at the blocks here on the right hand side, so if we look for receivers. There's a wideband one, and am I not seeing the narrowband? Oh, narrowband, sorry, NB, narrowband and wideband. So these are two different ones. The wideband one you'll probably use for normal FM radio stations, you know, 88 to 106 megahertz, and another one is for more 12.5 kHz to 25 kHz bandwidth modulations. So that's a different block you will then drag and move there. Then you've also got modulators and so on and so on. But there's a lot of blocks, so you can play a lot once you get your hands dirty. But maybe we want to see how this signal looks like before the filter and after filter. So what I'll do, I'll put an FFT in there. So I'll look for a fast Fourier transfer, this one, sync, and I'll drag it there. And I would like to see how this signal looks like that's coming out of the receiver. And it's going to show it to me there. And maybe I would like to see how it looks like after the filter. So I can put another one and look at, so we'll let it work and then I'll show, we'll take this FFT and put it before and after, and we can look at the difference. We can actually put a little scope in different places. We can look at our radio internally how it works. So we can do all that. This is the resampler. Remember I discussed that you have to maybe calculate the points in between sampling rates, or maybe you want less sampling rates. This is what you would use. So this is the input and output, the resampling. I think this is actually wrong. It should be 1 meg, 1.44 meg. So I think there's already a mistake here. Partiture rate should be the same as this one here. 1.44 meg, 1.44 E6. Right, and this should be same story. Yeah, that should be fine. It's the output. We want to convert it down to audio level. Okay, so we'll get it in, resample it to 48 kHz, because most of the audio systems in your laptop is 48 kHz or 44 kHz. You'll see, normally gives you the option between the two. And this is your audio sync. This is your actual audio card inside your laptop. You'll see, I think, if you've got a USB one, you'll see there is a sampling rate. Remember I said 48 kHz. And then I've linked this value to one of the variables I've got. Then I took the output from here and I also put it in the FFT so I can see the actual audio spectrum wise. And I've also added the scope, but I've disabled the scope. I'm going to show you this, how to enable and disable. You see this little block here. So if I click on it there, it enables the block. If I click on it there, this enables the block. So sometimes you could put little scope modules at different points in the radio while you're designing it, and you disable them, because otherwise the screen has got too many scopes and things, and then you can just quickly disable it and enable it. So as you're designing your radio, you put them there, disable them, and later on you want to see what I've done there, and you disable this one and enable the other one. Otherwise there's too many things on the screen, you'll see when we start using it. So that's basically a simple concept.
And Tom, can you just discuss baseband frequency? Because sometimes the baseband frequency is at the RF level, and other times baseband frequency is at the audio level.
Yeah, so...
What do they mean by baseband frequency?
Okay, so that's quite a very good question. Because if you think of... how SDR works in concept. If we've got a very fast analog to digital converter, we can actually sample the RF signal. Let's say we've got a 100 meg signal. To be able to represent an RF signal in a digital stream, we need to at least sample, they call it twice over. So it means I need to at least sample 200 meg. So I've got two dots, two points. If it's a sinus, there is a board here. Let me quickly show you on the board here. So if I've got a sinus wave like this, and this is a 100 meg signal, if I can sample twice, I might sample here and I might sample there. Now out of that I must reproduce this RF signal, right? They say that's at minimum. Now if my sampling rate is at least double what my RF is, that's my baseband signal. Right? Now what we've done here is we're cheating, because this RF SDR dongle has actually got a mixer in front. So we're not sampling the RF directly. We've got an input, and we've got a local oscillator, and this is probably sitting at 100 megahertz, and we'll have a baseband of coming out 1.44 megahertz. Right? So we're cheating. So what we're saying, the baseband in this case would be that 1.44. Okay? When we set the frequency here, we're actually setting the frequency of that mixer. But if we had a proper SDR front end, like the expensive ones that I'm talking about, 25 grand or so, they're sampling the RF directly. There's no mixer in between. Nothing. They're actually sampling the RF directly. And then you've got the capabilities of doing fantastic stuff. But we're cheating a bit, so we've got a front-end mixer, so it's not proper SDR. It's still got an analog signal mixer, so it can be fine. But that's good enough. It's good enough. So if you're doing satellite works, maybe it's not that good enough in the satellite itself, because you'll get so much better dynamic range, you'll get so much less signal to noise. We've got now two additional devices that can create noise. So we've got the local oscillator, a phase noise. We've also got the non-linearity of the actual mixer that generates noise. So we probably add 2 or 3 dBs here of noise because of the analog circuits in front. But if we've done it the RF way, then that would have disappeared. And in fact, if we did, let's say, an 8-bit resolution, let's say we split this thing up in capable measurement point, we've got an 8-bit version here, so we can have 255 points we can measure on an 8-bit system. On a 16-bit, it's what, 4096. You can imagine the dynamic range. Now, what is important about the dynamic range, if you look at the different sampling rate, this is an 8-bit sampling capability in front. If I've got two signals next to each other, to differentiate the strongest and the least strongest signal from each other, I can only do that in 255 points, because I've got 8 bits. So my dynamic range is limited to the maximum and minimum point. If I've got 4096, that range becomes so much bigger. So my adjacent channel disturbance is so much less. So you also will see that once you've got an 8-bit version, you might get 50 dB dynamic range, where if you go higher, you can get 80 to 90 dB dynamic range. That means from your least signal to your highest signal. You can still see it in the spectrum, you can still demodulate both at the same time. But if you've got less, you can only do it in that range. Now, what you can get away with, if you've got the automatic gain control, if the other signal is without the spectrum, then it doesn't matter. This one will move up, that one is out of view. But if they're in the same view angle of the filter, then you can do nothing. You're limited to the dynamic range of your strongest and least strongest signal. Okay, so that's concept that you must remember. Right, let's get this thing working. Let's plug in this dongle quickly. Okay, so we are receiving something. I didn't put a control. I'm using this little arrow here. I can't remember what's it, 145, 200. Let's see if we can transmit it. Okay, 1, 2.
There are 6 IC testing, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so there you saw my signal coming up and it's disappeared. And we're running a 6 alpha and a Charlie testing, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so I'm not listening exactly in the center frequency. That frequency, this frequency, will probably hear my modulation. ZR6 IC testing, 1, 2, 3. Just going to take it one frequency up. ZR6 IC testing, 1, 2, 3. Zulamir 6 alpha and a Charlie testing, 1, 2, 3. I haven't got the speaker plugged in now, but it's actually demodulating.
Yeah.
Let's put it there so you can probably hear it. Zulamir 6 alpha and a Charlie. Zulamir 6 alpha and a Charlie. IC testing 1, 2, 3. Zero 6 alpha and Charlie testing 1, 2, 3.
That's nothing.
Is there nothing? Sorry. Might not be on frequency. Let's take another one up. 0 6 IC testing 1, 2, 3. 0 6. It's almost in the middle. One more. 0 6. So just one more. 0 6 IC testing 1, 2, 3. So we're running a 6 alpha and a Charlie testing 1, 2, 3.
I'm going to plug it into the audio from your laptop.
Yeah, Hans, I think it's that it should be louder than this. I think I've got a mistake here somewhere. Just look at this. Oh, you know what? 1. I just want to look at the audio. I've got an audio tag if I can see it there. There are 6 IC testing 1, 2, 3. There are 6 IC testing 1, 2, 3. Hello, 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 hello. You can actually see it there. Let's try that.
Are you actually sending that out to a speaker on the radio?
Yeah, I'm actually going to send it to that speaker so hopefully we can hear it. I think the modulation, my bandwidth, it's a wide band demodulator I'm using, so it's going to be quite soft. So. Should be noise now. Huh? No. Let me see here. And find output. There are 6 IC testing 1, 2, 3. Do you run your 6? Alpha and Charlie testing 1, 2, 3. Okay, not on frequency either. Yes. See what I'm. Take the RF thing. There are 6 IC testing 1, 2, 3. The other one is not on frequency. I can hear I'm not on frequency. Let's see what I've set the frequency to.
Did you say 200? 145, 300.
Was it 1, 4, 5, 300? 1, 4, 5, 3, 100.
Is it 200?
Yeah. There are 6 IC testing 1, 2, 3. We only have 6 alpha and Charlie testing 1, 2, 3.
Did you say 145, 200?
Let me stop it. Let me just check in. 145, 300. But the frequency isn't spot on, so it could be a little bit up or down because I haven't calibrated this dongle. But okay, I'm not going to waste some more time. Maybe during the break I'll get it working properly. But you see how simple it was to sort of create a FM demodulator. Now there's SSB demodulators, there's all kinds of things that we can play around with in concept. There's a lot of these pre-designed stuff on the internet which you can download as a base and then start. Now we can put maybe FFT in front and after the audio, you know, so you can monitor what you've built.
Okay, that's a receiver. Let's do a transmitter. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to use the Hack RF. Actually forgot my Raspberry Pi at home. I actually wanted to transmit to the Raspberry Pi, but I left it in the other bag. So I'm going to use the Hack RF. So I'm just going to take the dongle out. I've sort of created this little circuit. I can maybe just talk you through it quickly. So I've got an audio source here, a signal source. So this is an actual audio generator. It will generate a tone at 1.75 kilohertz. Multiplier constant. If this audio level was too low, I could multiply it by 1.5 and make the amplitude higher or smaller. This is an adder. So, what I've done, when I want to switch this audio on and off, if I make the constant zero, it will not send an audio tone. If I make the constant one, it will send an audio tone. So I've used it as a switch. Created this adder, and here I've created the audio source, which is my microphone from my laptop. I've also put a constant thing here so I can switch it on and off. So now I can switch between a tone generator or my microphone as an input to a modulator. Okay, what I also have done, I've created a low pass filter because we want to sort of keep the deviation to a certain level. So low pass filter cutoff frequency at 4 kilohertz. Sampling rate at 8, audio rate is narrowband FM, audio in is 8 kHz, quadrature rate is 32 kHz. I've got a multiplier, again just in case the level is too low or too high. And then I use this as my RX-TX switch. When I want to switch my transmitter on, I put a 1 as a constant there, then it will feed the signal through. If I put a zero there, the transmitter switches off. Rational resample, remember I had to work out those points in between, resample, and the reason is all the way here it's 8 kilohertz, but this modulator requires, or this FFT, sorry, not FFT, the Osmocon sync, which talks to this Hack RF device, at minimum needs 1 meg sampling. So I have to convert my quadrature rate of 32 kHz to 1 meg. And I use this device, you'll see there's my dissemination of 32 kHz, which is the input stream, and I converted it up to 1 meg. So it now calculates the points in between. Remember I discussed it? So what we're doing here, so the quadrature rate is 32 kHz, the stream. So how many samples there is. I've taken that, I'll multiply it by 1, at the moment it's 0, but I'll multiply it by 1 so it will be the same signal. And this is my TX-RX switch. Then when it gets in here, I will take the 32 kHz and I'll calculate the points I needed for a 1 meg stream. So I'll create a 1 meg clock and calculate the points in between, and I'll send that to my modulator, my RF output, which is in this case is a Hack RF. Okay, just something, if you ever see these O's and U's and things, O means oversampling, U means undersampling. So if you've got a device that requires 1 meg in this case and you're probably sending 900 kilohertz, it's going to say under. If you're sending to the device and it needs 1 meg and you're sending it 1.1 meg, it will say over, which is O. So this actually tells you that you've got something mismatched from a bitrate point of view. So when you see that running at the bottom, you must find where somewhere you've got something that's not in sync. It probably still works. In most cases, if it's the two frequencies not far apart, but if it's far apart, then it won't work. Okay, so let's get this one working. So what it's doing now is compiling it. And it started up. So I'm just keeping this frequency. 5,
switch on my transmitter, it was just the on-off.
Hello, hello, hello? Oh, hello, hello?
It's not transmitting. You know why? It's because I don't even have got it plugged in. Okay. Unplug that dongle, I need to unplug this one in. Okay, Hack Arif. Remember on RTL dongles, there was a command called RTL underscore test, and it will just see if it sees a device. And Hack Arif is also a command called Hack Arif underscore info, and it should come back say seeing device. If it doesn't see the device, then you've got to know that you've got something wrong with your hardware. But I think it probably will work. Let's just see. You can hear the transmitter going on. And I'm going to switch my modulation on. Hello? It's echoing. Hello? Hello? Yeah, hold the FM transmitter.
Quite a bit of latency though, right?
Yeah, there is latency. It depends on the CPU and how many blocks you've got. Okay. So I've bought a transmitter, I've got an FFT analyzer on here, I can change my frequency. So by using this slider here, I can change the frequency and so on and so on. But in concept, I've bought a transmitter.
Amazing.
Okay, so I'm just gonna kill this quickly. So you can see here at the bottom I've created an enable tone. So if I do this one, I should generate a tone. Remember I added two inputs, the one was the microphone and the other one was the tone. Oh yeah, I transmit this also. There's a tone. A little bit over modulated, but I think I'm not spot on frequency as well. I'm also a bit too close. You can hear the tone. And if I switch the tone off. Hello? Now it's just the mic. Okay, in concept of, let's kill that. So basically what we've gone through here, and how many blocks is it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and I didn't even need all these blocks. If I didn't want the slider and if I didn't want this, I could have left off a lot of blocks and just hard-coded the values in there. So that's a simple transmitter. Now what you must remember from a Hack RF point of view, the output of this is no proper output filtering for that band, so you need a low-pass filter or a band-pass filter if you want to then create a power amp stage and output for testing, analysis, sweeping, building your radio. It's a good start to get you going. And then obviously you can probably build a filter. Let's say you're interested in HF and build a 40 meter band pass or a low pass and a 20 meter or whatever, and then power amp stage and so on and so on. And you can buy those modules as well. But this is a very fantastic, good product to get you going. Right, so I think that's a transmitter. We can go through some of the other blocks. Let's just try and test the audience quickly. Is there specific blocks that you're interested in?
You've got 2 and 5 minutes.
Okay, yeah, so we've got 5 minutes. Is there specific blocks you want me to dive into or talk about? Let's go through some of them. Let's just show you what's out there, because your mind is suddenly going, boom, I can do all this stuff, but what is available off the shelf at the moment from a blocks point of view?
Is GNU available as a free, or do you have to buy?
No, it's free, it's all open source. It's all open source.
Open source,
it's free.
Because GNU originally had to...
No, never, it's open source from day one. No, it's free.
And on your...
Yeah.
5 dBs.
Yes.
Up to what frequency can you go on that?
Right. So remember, I told you in the beginning, I spoke to the developer. There's a good chance that the new library will take us up to 1.2 gig. Using third or fourth harmonic. If you're looking at second harmonic as it is standing now, up to 500 meg. So I think up to 250 is first carrier, so that the pin is actually modulated, and then after that it's second harmonic, and then the other one harmonics is used for the higher frequencies.
So by three?
Yeah, you can use a two or a three, okay. any of the two, they work
well,
fine.
Well, the two also better then?
Yeah. Well, I haven't tested it with the new libraries to go that high. I must actually go and check on this site if it's maybe not just three.
Yeah,
I'm not sure. But that's basically it. So I've done a board that you can build up for any filter band you want, HF, VHF, UHF. That's a little board that I'll show you. I've maybe got the kit. I can just show you how the board looks like so you've got an idea. So it's a small little board this big, and there's seven components you built for a 2 meter transmitter. And the board allows you to build any other band, and I've got the data for the other bands, but the kit comes with components for the 2 meter one. So that's one way of starting. Unfortunately, 35 milliwatts, so the gain is experimental. I've got power and amp stages for it. If you want it, I think I've got a 4 watt for 2 meters, and 2 watt for 70 centimeters. There will be a new board coming out in about a month's time with a 3 watt power amp stage on board.
Nice APRS system.
Very nice APRS system. I've used this in a balloon. I don't know if you guys have read my latest paper on how to create telemetry for balloons. If you go and read that, this is what I was using in the balloon with the last time. Again, I lost the signal because I miscalculated the distance. I calculate the balloon will go 25 kilometers up, 35 milliwatts, maybe just will do it. But then it traveled 25 kilometers, no, actually more. It was 100 and something kilometers away, which I didn't take in consideration. So 35 milliwatts is not exactly enough. That's why I'm building the more powerful board. So I'm probably going to build them up in the future. They're still kids. A 2 meter, a 70 centimeter. A 20 meter and a 40 meter version. Okay, so that's that. Just quickly jump here. Do we still have time or do we gonna go for tea?
You've got a few minutes. You can't run into Vince's time too much. He's got lots to say.
How long do you want to talk for? I'm glad we'll be fine.
Must I talk about the HF noise?
No, that's after. That's after.
Okay.
After this.
Okay, let me just do this thing. I just want to quickly show you.
But there's lots of non-believers out there. When I gave the club presentation 2 weeks ago, and I said to them what was capable on the Raspberry Pi, they said to me, impossible.
Yeah.
No ways you can do it.
Yeah, myself, when I got this working, I don't know if you saw my first video when I did it that one night. I was jumping this high in the house, running around myself. I said, what's wrong with you? Just sit down. And I created a video, I put it in the internet, I think went, wow, people couldn't believe it, you can do it. That was building the FM repeater with this module. Okay, so I've written this document when we did the last bar card, and there's quite a bit of details. I use this little module, the one I've just spoken about, and how to configure it, how to set it up, how to use it, how the commands work, how to build a complete telemetry system by using these little command utilities, how to configure it, so on, get you going, how to do temperature measurements and send it with telemetry down. Yes, filter, additional filter boards if you want a split antenna, if you want to build a transponder, you will see. Come to UNSET conference and I'll show you some how to build a transponder. Yeah, you know, go and have a look. There's a lot of information there, and hopefully the new boards that will bring out, you know, for long distance. I think that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anton.
Thanks very much, Anton. We'll have another session with him after the antenna session, but that's and have something to eat. There's some really nice things out there. So, come on up yourself. Let's sort of get back in 15 minutes.